Hello everyone, this is Nicolas from P2 Design, and today's video is a direct following of Pyrex Multiple Smear Effect inside Blender 3's tutorial video. We're going to implement this from Blender 3 to Unity Engine. So let's get started. We see two different methods on how to make this effect. First with Unity's Animator tool, and then with Shader Graph and Shuriken Particle System Editor. For this tutorial, we will be using Blender 3.1 and Unity 2020.3. Note that depending on the version you will be using, you might not have access to the same tools and interface as presented in this tutorial. This is why I highly recommend you to use the same software's versions. We start with Unity's Animator Tool method. As the name suggests, we'll be using the Animator Tool to animate individual meshes, making them appear and disappear at specific frames. We first need to get our 3D mesh containing the multiple smear effect right. Pyrex delivered me this combined mesh containing all smear meshes for the video. Each smear mesh has only one UV set and has the same UVs as the character scythe. You can learn how to make those cool smear meshes by watching his multiple smear effect in Blender 3's tutorial video. The link will be in the description below. So let's boot up Blender and get to work. We'll first select the entire combined mesh, switch to Edit Mode, go to the Mesh menu, Separate, and click on the option By Loose Part. Back to Object Mode, we'll select all the meshes, go to File, and export them as a single FBX entity. I'll freeze the video for you to copy the FBX exports option. Our 3D object is now good to go. Let's switch to Unity now. Here we are in a Unity scene with our character. Its animator and materials are already set up. We'll drag and drop the 3D mesh we've just exported from Blender into our character and make sure the position and rotation of the mesh are correct. Since the scythe smear submeshes has the same UVs as the scythe weapon willed by the character, we'll just async the scythe metal on them by selecting the multiple submeshes and drag the said metal to the metal slot of the mesh renderer module. Then we'll select the multiple smear mesh and add an animator component. We'll access the animation window by going to the window menu, animation, and clicking on animation. We'll then create the animation clip of the multiple smear mesh by clicking on the create button on the animation window. Before starting the animation process, here's a quick overview of the animation window. This is the playback controls bar, where you've got playback and frame navigation controls. Under the playback controls is the animation clip selector, allowing you to switch between multiple animation clips within the same animator. And right next to it, you'll find the frame counter, displaying the current frame where the playback head is located. This is the animated properties list, where every game object properties that can be animated will be listed after adding them with the Add Property button, ranging from some mesh renderer options to shader properties and, of course, position, scale and rotation of 3D models. This is the animation clip's timeline, where we can see any keyframes recorded, and finally, you can also switch from the drop sheet view to the curve view, allowing you to fully control how keys are being interpolated between one another. We can finally start animating the different submeshes. We'll do a pretty simple animation where we'll just activate and deactivate individually each submeshes and sync this animation clip with the character's cleave animation. We will reach the Add Property button inside the animation window and add to each submeshes the property named isActive, resulting in the addition of a key in the animation clip's timeline. Since we don't want them visible at the start and at the end of the animation, we'll just deactivate them for now. We'll now take a look at the character's cleave animation by selecting the character in the hierarchy window. We want the smear submeshes clip animation to have the same length as the cleave's animation to make it loop. We'll also check at which frame the character's scythe is roughly aligned with each individual smear submeshes to get the right spawn timing. In our case, we can note that the animation is 60 frames long and that the size is roughly aligned with each sub-meshes at frame 21.5, 22.5, 24, 25, and 26. We got all we need. Time to get back to the multiple smooth animation clip by selecting it in the hierarchy window. Disclaimer, by default, Unity runs its animation at 60 FPS, and in our case, this character's animation was exported in 30 FPS from Blender. If we would use the same keyframes number we took note earlier to create our animation clip, it would result in a desync between the cliff attack's animation and the smear mesh's animation. So, to sync up the cliff's animation and the multiple smooth animation clip, we'll roughly double up the frames number. After setting the last keys of the animation clip at frame 132, we'll now tick the isActive Boolean property for each individual submesh, proceeding by the position order to keep the flow and direction of the character's weapon, and untick it one frame later. We have now our multiple smear effect done, with each smear mesh spawning in the right order and lasting one frame to support the cliff animation. We got a nice basic animation here, but there is still room for improvement left. Feel free to experiment by tweaking the frame's hold duration or the spawning delay of the multiple smear submeshes. And with those final tweaks, we are done. It's quick and easy to set up. Now, let's do it the funky way with Shader Graph and Shuriken Particle System Editor. This method is about making the effect work through a particle system that will allow us to control the spawning delay, duration, and lifetime of the multiple smear mesh, but also to control the way each submeshes appear and disappear on screen through the use of a padding line texture that will serve as an opacity mask, making them visible when they are white and invisible when they are black. To make the opacity mask technique work on our mesh, we'll need to have a different mesh than the one we exported earlier in the video. We'll need it to have a second special UV set and to be one single 3D object without any submeshes. In Blender, to merge multiple submeshes into one single 3D mesh, you just have to be in object mode, select all submeshes, right-click and select the Join option. Now we create our second UV set. But why do we need another UV set, you wonder? As you can see, the first UV set is essential to be left as it is if you want the slice texture to be correctly applied on all smear submeshes. But it makes the task difficult to have a moving mask that will make appear each submesh in a desired order to support the character's cleave animation. This is where a second UV set comes handy, for it will allow us to keep the texture of the size and easily apply the padding gradient on each submesh in a sweeping motion. We'll just have to flatten each submesh's UV island and place them in a kind of chronological spawning order. Open the UV editing viewport layout while being in edit mode with vertex selection activated. Press A to select all vertices of the entire mesh. Go to the Object Data Properties menu and unfold the UV Maps list. This is our first UV set containing the UV unwrap made for the site's texturing, and we will create the second UV set with this Add button and make it the active UV set by clicking on the camera icon. Go to the UV menu and select Project from View. This will create a UV unwrap based on the editor's current view. We will then switch to UV Island selection in the UV viewport. Place in order of appearance each submesh's UV island, give them enough spacing, roughly the width of the opacity mask line, and squeeze them flat. Our 3D mesh is now ready to be exported to Unity Engine. The opacity mask texture will be quick to make. In a new Blender scene, we will delete the default cube, switch to the texture paint viewport, create a new image, touch the paint window until we can access the stroke menu. We'll then click on the stroke method list and select a line. We will set the radius up to 131, and now we can paint a straight line by left clicking while maintaining Alt from the bottom to the top of the canvas. With that done, we can export the opacity texture by going to the image menu and select Save As. We now got all our external assets ready. Let's get back to Unity. In our particle system spawning our multiple smear mesh, to control how the opacity mask will move, we'll have to create a special shader where we'll be able to access custom vertex data, allowing us to use a curve to control the movement of the panning line opacity mask during the particle lifetime. We'll start by creating the set shader by right-clicking in the project window, create, shader, universal render pipeline, and selecting the lit shader graph template and click on open shader editor. The shader we create will be divided in two groups, one containing all textures sampler for the visual rendering of the size, and the other containing the opacity mask and custom vertex data setup. Note that in my case, the site textures has been made using a specular workflow. So for those textures to be correctly read by the shader, we'll go to the Graph Inspector window and change the workflow property from metallic to specular. We will also tick the alpha clip option to allow our mesh's opacity to be controlled by the line mask we did earlier in Blender. We will then add 5 texture 2D properties in the blackboard window for the sites diffuse, normal, specular and smoothness, emission, and opacity mask textures. In the blackboard window, after selecting a texture 2D property, we can go to the graph inspector and assign the right texture to it. We will do it for each texture 2D property we referenced in our shader. Back to create the specular workflow setup, we'll create 4 2D texture sampler. Drag and drop each texture 2D and link them respectively into each texture sampler. We just need then to link each texture sampler to the corresponding master node input. Now we'll quickly make the custom vertex data setup and see how it's working right after. We'll create a UV node, link it to a split node, and we'll connect the blue and alpha channel to the red and green input of a combined node. Then we'll link the RG output of the offset input of a tiling and offset node with a UV channel selector set to UV1. After that, we'll just connect the output to a simple texture 2D's UV input and plug in our opacity mask texture 2D in the texture input. And finally, link the red channel to the master node's alpha input. Now that we've created the setup, let's take a closer look at what is going on. First, the red and green channels are used by the UV set 0 to correctly display the textures of the site made in a specular workflow, and the blue and alpha outputs of the UV set 0 correspond to the Z and W values of the vertex custom data option custom1.xy in the particle system we will create shortly after this. Those two values can be individually controlled through curves in the particle system to offset or to move the texture in the UV space. More specifically, the texture will be moved in the UV space of the second UV set of our mesh on the X or the Y axis, thanks to the UV set selector of the tile and offset node. Now we just have to create a material out of our newly made shader by right clicking on it and selecting material. Since we already assigned our textures during the shader creation part, they are already assigned to our newly created material. And with that done, we can finally start the last part of this tutorial, the particle system setup. We will now create particle system by right-clicking in the hierarchy window, select effects and particle system. We will modify the renderer module to display our multiple smear mesh with the correct material by going to the render mode list, select mesh, assign the combined multiple smear mesh we did earlier in Blender, assign the material we did a minute ago, and set the render alignment to local. We won't need the shape module, so we'll just deactivate it for now, and in the emission module, we'll set the rate over time value to 0, add burst list, and set the count to 1, for we only want one mesh to be spawned each time the particle system will be called. In the global module, we'll set the start speed to 0, for we do not want our mesh to be moving, and if necessary, you can realign your 3D mesh by ticking the 3D start rotation option and register a more desirable value into one of the 3 axes. With the opacity mask already applied, we can only see a part of our 3D mesh. If we want to check if the entire mesh is fully drawn, we will change the view mode in the same window and select a wireframe or shaded wireframe. Now we'll activate the custom vertex data streams so the particle system can interact with the custom vertex data setup we made earlier in our shader. We will add the custom 1.xy property to be able to use the blue and alpha channel of the UV set 0 as curves, and the UV2 property so the particle system recognizes the second UV set of our mesh. We can now activate the custom data module, set the mode of the custom mode sum menu to vector, and register 1 as the value of number of components, for we will only move the opacity texture on one axis. As we change X's value, the opacity mask is moving and making each of our smear submeshes visible and invisible. We will set the X property mode to curve to control its value over the lifetime of our mesh inside the particle system. Note that you'll have to find the right curve values, for it will highly depend on your mesh's second UV set unwrap and the position and width of your opacity textures line. Now we will sync the particle system and the character's cleave animation. Using the animation window, while our character is selected, we can note that the animation is 60 frames long and that the sight starts to be roughly aligned with the first submesh at frame 22 and is roughly aligned with those submeshes for approximately 5 frames. We now need to convert those frames into seconds, knowing that this animation was exported in 30 fps. The animation, or particle system duration, is 2.2 seconds long, start at 0.63 seconds, which correspond to our particle system's delay, and last for roughly 0.18 seconds, which is our particle lifetime. After assigning those values into our particle system, we are done. It will now be up to you and or your developer to choose how to spawn this multiple smear effect through the use of scripts, whether you choose the animator or the shader particle system way. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I see you next time. Bye bye!